What if when authors pass away, they look down upon the earth and see a light anytime somebody reads one of their works? If that were the case, this might be the world according to James Joyce, where on the other hand, this would be the world of Wilson Harris. But in an alternate reality, Wilson Harris might see something like this. This is the author I always wanted to pay a visit to, but then I thought he was immortal. He just kept living. He lived up into his 90s and just recently passed away, 2018. When he was younger, he looked kind of like Billy Dee Williams. He started out as a surveyor working for the government, where his expeditions took him deep into the South American rainforest, where he got in touch with these lost and forgotten tribes. And it wasn't until much later, 1960, that he started writing. And the first book of his that he put out, Palace of the Peacock, is remarkable because this book contains all of the seed elements that he would then unravel and massage and contemplate for the rest of his career. The next 50 years, over 25 books, all of them put out by Faber. From the very start, it seemed like his project and his vision was so assured and self-encapsulated that it seems like he's just been writing one long entire novel throughout his career. And it's like this quilt that he just keeps adding to. Maybe it gets a little bit more dense towards the end. And the cool thing about it is that you could just jump in on any book because you can't really tell where one book ends and the next begins. I don't think Wilson Harris was really directly considered part of the group of British experimentalists from the 1960s, like Alan Burns or Anne Quinn, except maybe through Zulfikar Ghosh, who was close friends with B.S. Johnson. So I just jumped in and I was completely ignorant of all the academic assessments about Wilson Harris and his place in post-colonial literature and his disruptions against the traditional. I was just amazed and blown away by the surface of his language, which seemed very poetic and dreamlike and surreal. And in this book, which I've read like so many times, every time I come back to this book, it's like a new one. Gets pulled out and tossed into the sky and stabs a flying creature, and then everything gets converted into quantum mechanics, and you start to realize that the narrator is walking along a river where the past of it is completely malleable, and he seems to have this ability to talk to ghosts, and you start to realize that maybe he himself is a ghost, that not only in this book but in all of Wilson Harris's books, that all of these figures in here.
There's something very telling in this first novel where he mentions a crew that is going on an expedition.
The writing of Wilson Harris suggests a multiplicity of sensors, all possible combinations of which arise as a result of the passage of time.
We have come to a very serious time in our history, in which we have to ask ourselves whether the direction we are pursuing is wrong, whether the sails we have put up, under which we move, are oriented to the wrong trend, the wrong wind, the wrong tide, whether we have to turn and go in a different direction, completely different direction. The questions we have to ask ourselves about nature. Nature ails. If one looks, for example, as the fantastic films of outer space, which are simulated, what do you see? You see meteors striking planets, gouging out great bits of planets, causing explosions as if those planets are vomiting, they're ill. There is an ailment running through nature, and we have to see that all of us, in some degree, have caught the virus.
A writer who's capable of working with these dimensions is rare enough, and when I found out that he passed away last year, it really messed with my head. Like right before
sleep, that fear of death came creeping back, where, you know, in only 80 or 90 years, all of us will be swallowed by darkness. You feel like you're a kid again, wondering what happens when you die.
When you die, what if there's nothing after you die? What if there's just plain darkness and you can feel the darkness and there's nothing you can do about it? And the same could be in life. When you're old, when you could forget everyone, you could have gone senile and then you'll be unrecognizable from your own family. And then when you die someday, no one will remember you at all. You're just gone from the world. Everyone will forget you, and there's nothing you can do about it. There's millions of people, millions of nice people, millions of people that torture people, other people that are dead from 3000 BC, they will still be out there thinking that nobody is there to comfort them, to be with them. And people say that death is the next adventure, but what if there's nothing after it? What if there's absolutely nothing but loneliness forever?
So the only way I felt I could pay homage to his memory was to visit his writing firsthand, still living on the page. You hope that he managed to transcend space and time, and that his spirit is out there somewhere, fighting the good fight for all of us.